Patnaik, Asutosh ji, my former colleague in the union, Alvina ji, and distinguished professor who are present here, and my dear friends, students of JNU. First of all, I am thankful to the JP Manch, floated by one of the prolific out-of-box thinker of this university, Professor Anand Kumar, to have initiated this dialogue in this fifth decade of this university, which has given us what we are today. Speaking for myself, coming from a science background, I have physics on the sports. My father and grandfather being lawyer in the district court, after I completed my BSc in physics, my father saw to it that this guy is not going to do any good. He advised me to take law, admissible law. But coming from the court district of Odisha, Kalahandi, I had this in mind that someday I would like to be in JNU. It so happened that I wrote the exam and I got selected in SIS. And thereafter, for me, the things that changed were transformative. I got the opportunity to be part of the student movement in JNU. Fought elections, won the councillor post twice for the joint secretary and went on to become the president of the student union. And that election still is etched in my memory, as would be in the memories of many people who were there around that time. Because I won by a single vote. Unthinkable, you would think, in many scenario. But thanks to JNU, that single vote made me the president of the student union. So that is the contribution of JNU insofar as student activism is concerned, insofar as various other things are concerned. But as I said in the beginning, if we are entering into the fifth decade of our existence as a university, it would be worthwhile also to relook, or maybe relook within, to know whether the contributions that have been made by our university is in tune with the object for which this university was established. I don't know how many of you would have heard of the name Mohammad Karim Chagla. Can I have a show of hands? Okay. Thank you, sir. So in fact, till I joined JNU and much thereafter, I was not knowing myself that Mr. Chagla was instrumental in setting up this university single-handedly. And the irony is that in today's time, nobody remembers him. You would be thinking as to why I am invoking Mr. Chagla, who was and still is one of the distinguished jurists that this country has produced. He was and still is one of the distinguished diplomat that this country has produced. And he was and still is one of the best education minister that this country has ever given to the democratic system. So it so happened that he thought to himself at that point in time, mid-60s, when Delhi University was being, was the only university in Delhi, he thought it proper that there should be another university. And during Mr. Nehru's lifetime, he spoke to him and told him that, look, I want to establish a university and I want to name it after you. Nehru being Nehru, he was not in favor of it. And during the time when the bill was introduced into the parliament, there was heated debate as to whether a university is to be named after a particular person. But as things stand today, the bill was passed, and I don't know how many of us has read this statute. And why I'm talking like an advocate that I am is, because the object for which this university was set up in 1969 still holds good. And the object of the university is enshrined in section 4 of this statute. If at all you ever get a chance, please have a look at this statute. And this schedule which has been appended to this statute. Why I am again and again talking about the legal process that set JNU coming to be in motion is that the university was set up to welcome ideas, liberal ideas, to study all the branches of languages, all the languages rather of India, to study Indian culture and give a platform to the needy, to the downtrodden. And when you are talking about the contribution of this university to the nation, I'll give you one anecdote which is personally known to me, of a student who was there along with us and belonged to the same part of Odisha. And I got to know this after long after I left the university. He came from a very poor background, didn't have any wherewithal to sustain himself, and apparently he was so poor that they didn't have a radio set also. And during the, I don't know how many of you still listen to All India Radio, now also around 9 to 10, sort of like various discussions that happens. And many a time students from JNU, professors from JNU do participate in such discussions. And apparently that student used to listen to those, you know, discussions. And by virtue of the knowledge that he gathered from that, he sat for the entrance, he got through and came to JNU. Became an active member of the Dramatic Society, got appointed as a permanent faculty in DU, but since his heart was in dramatics and other things, now he is trying to find a foothold in Mumbai Film Industry. So this is what JNU has done to him. And this is an anecdote which you'll find resonating with many people all around you, many students who have passed out. So when we talk about the contribution of any university or for that matter any institution, what are the parameters? For the last 1 year, one has been listening and at times one feels very proud that Mr. So-and-so, Mr. So-and-so, Mr. So-and-so, Mrs. So-and-so are in the government. Mr. XYG are the top-notch bureaucrats who are manning the various departments of the country. Mr. So-and-so has gone in to become so-and-so. And so on and so forth. So is this the only criteria by virtue of which you will judge the contribution of the university? Could be one. And when I applied this logic, somebody retorted, so what? Allahabad University has produced many more luminaries than JNU. BHU may have produced. There are other state universities which have produced many more luminaries who have contributed to the growth of that particular part of the country or state. So what is the distinguishing feature? A valid point, I would say. So my point is that just because many people chose a particular vocation and they went on to do well, that cannot be the only parameter. JNU has to be judged as to what it has given us. Yes, it has given us a fair admission policy where deprivation point is given to students coming from the various tribes, districts of the country. Deprivation is also given to various female candidates so that they can get admission here. We have a robust student union election where everything is managed by the students, and more often than not all the student union elections and all elections are conducted in a peaceful manner. And above all, JNU provides us a platform to air our views. As Asutosh just pointed out, from any background, any ideology, you get a platform in JNU to air your views. But looking back, I would say that the time has come for us to not sit on the laurels that JNU has gathered over the last 5 decades. And if you may so desire of you, if you allow me, I would like to introspect for myself as to where JNU could have contributed much more than what we have today. So the way the university was established and the system that has worked in the last 5 decades, there is a prevalent feeling, rightly or wrongly, I am not sitting in judgment, that the system of appointment and other processes are in the grey area, it is not in black and white, and there is a grey area, so to say. And it has been seen and witnessed that candidates of a particular ideological persuasion have found favor while getting recruited. As I said, I am not sitting in judgment, but this is a valid point that is raised time and again by various folks. The other critic, so to say, or other introspection, so to say, really could be a wrong word to use, because I don't like to critique in this platform, but I would like to introspect. And I'll go back to the object of the university for which it was set up. The university was set up to propagate and study Indian culture, Indian language. And I still remember during my student days and activism days, when the School of Sanskrit was about to be set up, there was an uproar and hue and cry that was raised. And again, the level that was given was saffronization of education. At that point in time, I didn't have the benefit of studying the statute. And in hindsight, I would like to say that maybe those who were protesting against such a setting up a Sanskrit center would have done better to have a look at the statute of the university, because it is the constitutional document that matters. Whenever we talk about the Indian democracy, all the time would like to show to our opponent, look, this is what constitution says, look, this is what fundamental rights are all about, and then start the debate. And we judge the Indian democracy or Indian state as such in the parameter of how it has functioned in meeting the constitutional criteria that our forefathers, constitutional forefathers, have set for ourselves. Applying those criteria into JNU, I am sorry to say that our contribution to the nation could have been much, much more had we kept ourselves alive to the statute book that set JNU into motion, or still governs JNU. Elaborating on this point, I am sorry to say that this university could have been a hub and still had the opportunity to be a hub of studying and researching and critiquing Indian philosophers, Indian thought leaders, be it Avinash Gupta, be it Swami Vivekananda, be it Aurobindo, be it Chanakya, be it Charvaka. But I don't know if after I left JNU any research has been encouraged in this field, but till such time that I was in JNU, the common refrain was that these are topics or no-go area for students. I am not invoking these names because of the ideological leaning that I have, and I am proud of that ideological leaning, but I am invoking these names just to show and just to submit before this gathering that if JNU would have taken up the research in these areas, maybe JNU would have given a different dimension to the Indian thought process. And maybe they talk about the overarching, you know, system taking over JNU would not have happened. Maybe a different thought process would have come about from JNU. So this is one area which is close to my heart. And yesterday I read that a chair has been set up and some contribution has been made for Upanishads and other Indian philosophical literature will be studied, and there will be a grant for that. Good enough. I don't know how the JNU community is going to take introduction of such field of research. Another area that is close to my heart is where JNU could have contributed much, much more is that Asutosh ji said that, you know, JNU gave a platform, but I had a different experience, Asutosh ji, and I would like to share that here. And that was when I just entered JNU, when it so happened that I got drawn into the vortex, so to say, of student politics. And being from a place where student politics would mean what Asutosh ji just described as used to be in Allahabad, when one used to campaign, and that memory is still etched in my mind, it so happened that I knocked on the door of a particular person, and when I introduced myself, that person says, look, you are from AVP, I am not going to talk with you. And I got, ठीक है सर, बात मत करिए, आप तो मिला नहीं. I don't know what was with him that day, maybe he had a fight with his guide or what, God knows what. But he said, no, आपसे हाथ भी नहीं मिला. It's a small thing, but then, you know, invoking AVVP got that reaction from him. Maybe it was a one-off thing, so, but then, it gets as in your memory. The other thing that comes to my mind is, as JNUites, we are very proud to say that, look, in JNU, nothing matters. Nor your caste, nor your religion, nor your background. Background, yes, to some extent I agree that your background doesn't matter. But when it comes to the political, so to say, working of the campus, you would bear with me that all these things matter. So, as a university which was supposed to be a place where liberal thought process was hoped to hold sway, whether it was a good thing, whether it is still a good thing, that all these things matter and whether we have done anything to introspect so as to get over this thing. The other thing that is close to my heart is that, again, it is related to the ideological persuasion that one has, and that one has seen in many instances, students being, I'll not use the word victimized, but because victimized would demean this university, but students being discriminated because they believed and followed a particular ideological persuasion. I have known instances where one of the quote-unquote eminent professor of one of the center of excellence awarded by JNE saw to it that a close friend of mine, and he never spoke about it any time, but during the last 1 year, when we met after a long, long time, he brought this up and he told me that his guide, who happened to be also an NEC member in the last dispensation that we sent out, saw to it that his PhD was not awarded. And I was shocked when I knew the name as to who the professor was. And the kind of writing the professor used to write, the kind of views that the professor used to propagate, one had always thought that the professor would be above this. But then, this is the sad state of affairs, and that gets repeated even now also. Another thing that JNE could have done much, much more is that giving space to our various ideological persuasions. As I said, and I have seen this firsthand, that particular persuasion, or a particular persuasion to which I belong, was ostracized in some manner for a long, long period of time. And I think that continues till now also. Belonging to that ideological persuasion, I would not care about that. But then I would also think that had the persuasion been co-opted, had the persuasion been given its due at the right point in time, maybe JNE would have been different. Talking about how the media has treated JNE in the last 1 year, I would like to remind oneself and the JNE community at large is, we are living in a time where social media explosion is taking place. I was just reading about JNU's history, and this is one area that I would request Professor Patnaik to recommend to the administration, that all these students who take admission in JNU are taught about its history so as to know as to what JNU stands for. So when I was reading this book written by one of the professors in JNU, the incident of 83, I don't know how many of you would remember what happened in 83. There was a signing riot and JNE was sucked for about 6 months, for some time. And at that point in time also, professors of JNU held a discussion. And the topic of discussion was, at that point in time, I'm talking about 83, more than 30 years back, whether JNU has become a sick place. Imagine the kind of attention it would have drawn in today's time. Because social media was not there, TV was not there. Only thing at that point in time was print media. So my point is, JNU and the working of JNU has been discussed threadbare in the past also. Media has scrutinized various things that happened in JNU in the past also. And in the last 1 year, whatever has happened, for right or wrong, since we are not debating about that, but the kind of persuasion, the kind of thought processes that have been brought into in JNU, you may have your right of freedom of expression and what not, but your freedom of expression cannot be allowed to say Bharat ke tukde karenge, Kashmir is not part of India, Bastar mange Azadi and all that, because that cannot be the teaching of JNU, because JNU definitely gives you a space to hear your views, but not at the cost of the country, not at the cost of the security of the country. Coming back to the media reports what it sees. Some of the media houses may be believing in TRPs and crest commercialism or whatnot. But the fact remains that even if the media says anything about JNU, we'll have to tell the media, or for that matter, world at large, as to what JNU stands for. And this is one area, and then during that time, And last year, because all these things had happened, and maybe that was the backdrop to starting of this series of lectures. During that time, I was interviewed by one of the leading web portals, and I had specifically said that JNU has taught us what we are today. JNU gives you the space to listen. We, being the former students of JNU, are proud of JNU. But the campaign that was launched at that point in time to save JNU, at that point in time, I raised a question. I don't know if it is valid or not, but I thought it is valid as a former student of JNU, as to from whom you are going to save JNU. Are you going to save JNU from the vested interests who have got entrenched in JNU, and they are using JNU as a platform, JNU's university system as a platform, to protect their right because they have been questioned? Or are you going to protect or save JNU as an idea which has given many students from far-flung areas of India a platform to study and nurture their ideas? So this is one question which remains in my mind, and I would like to know from you as to what it means to save JNU. And at a larger platform, the debate that was built with JNU is under attack. JNU cannot be under attack so long as JNU sticks to what the objects of the statute are. JNU cannot be attacked, and even if somebody attacks JNU, the attack will be repelled. The person who will attack JNU will take a step back and think that it is not the right thing to do. So my concluding thoughts would be that as a university, we have contributed a lot, but there is a lot more to achieve in the coming days. And as we will be entering the fifth decade, we have already entered the fifth decade of existence, new thoughts ought to be welcome, new discussions ought to be welcome, and hardening of positions, what one has seen in the last one or couple of years that has developed in the campus, has to be softened. The process of dialogue has to be reinitiated. One has to act in an impartial manner so as to see to it that the objective of JNU are achieved. Thank you.